E-props have truly innovated by creating a ground adjustable propeller that creates optimum thrust not only at takeoff or only in cruise like a typical propeller, but in all phases of flight, similar to an in-flight adjustable pitch propeller. And this is without any mechanical variable pitch mechanism, but instead via something called ESR, or extended speed range. I'll explain how they achieve ESR in a manner that doesn't require an aeronautical engineering degree to understand. Before I proceed, this video is not sponsored by eProps or created in collaboration with them. It's entirely my own work, and since I only have access to publicly available information from eProps, some conclusions are drawn based on general aerodynamic principles. And while I don't currently fly an eProps propelled airplane, we have owned one and I have flown behind one, so I have first-hand experience with its operation and characteristics. To understand the design decisions of eProps, it's important to be reminded of a few fundamental concepts about propellers. A normal fixed pitch or ground adjustable propeller typically only produces optimal thrust in a very narrow airspeed range. A fine pitch setting produces optimal thrust only at low airspeed, and a coarse pitch setting produces optimal thrust only at high airspeed. A propeller works much like an airplane's wing in terms of angle of attack. When air hits the chord line at 0 degrees, there is little vertical displacement of air and almost no lifting force is created. As angle of attack increases, more air is displaced downward, generating greater lift, or thrust in the case of a propeller. However, this holds true only up to the critical angle of attack. Exceeding it stalls the airfoil, causing the airflow over the top to separate from the upper surface, resulting in turbulent flow and a significant loss of lift or thrust. With propeller blades, the concept becomes more complex though. The angle at which the blade cuts through the air results from a combination of the blade's rotational speed and the airplane's forward speed. As the airplane accelerates, the relative airflow shifts, reducing the blade's angle of attack and consequently decreasing the thrust it generates. So with fixed pitch or ground adjustable propellers, the faster the airspeed, the lower the maximum thrust the propeller can create. And this places a relatively low limit on the maximum cruise speed of an airplane. This effect can be mitigated by setting a ground adjustable propeller to a coarser pitch, which allows the blades to generate more thrust at higher air speeds. However, this adjustment comes with a trade-off. The lower the airspeed, the more the blade's angle of attack increases. That sounds good. More angle of attack means more thrust, right? Yes, but only up to a point. When the blade's angle of attack exceeds critical, it stalls and produces less thrust. A very coarse blade pitch, optimized for fast cruise speeds, can cause the blades to operate in partially or even fully stalled condition during the initial part of takeoff. This results in significant drag while producing far from optimal thrust. A fine pitch propeller provides good takeoff thrust but causes the engine to reach maximum RPM quickly as the airplane accelerates. This is due to the blades getting progressively less loaded as the airplane speeds up due to the decreasing blade angle of attack. To avoid exceeding the engine's maximum RPM, throttling back is often necessary, reducing power and thrust. On the other hand, a coarse pitch propeller generates less thrust during takeoff due to partially stalled blades, but still heavily loads the engine due to high blade angle of attack, resulting in lower engine RPM, and lower RPM means reduced horsepower. This severely compromises takeoff performance and safety, so blade pitch needs to be set to a compromised middle ground, not too coarse, but not too fine either. The reality is that most fixed pitch and ground adjustable propeller planes end up with suboptimal performance in both takeoff and cruise, performing at their best only in a very narrow range of airspeed in between. The ideal solution to this problem is in-flight adjustable pitch propellers. However, these come with drawbacks like increased mechanical complexity, which results in high purchase and maintenance costs, and they are usually quite heavy too. In-flight adjustable propellers are also more complex to operate than fixed pitch ones. Furthermore, in many countries, light sport aircraft are not permitted to use in-flight adjustable propellers. This is where ESR, or extended speed range propellers, come into play. What is ESR? As the name suggests, it refers to propellers that maintain efficiency across a wider range of airspeeds compared to standard propellers. ESR can be achieved through various means, one of which involves designing the propeller to automatically adjust its pitch without relying on a mechanical system. Here's how it works. When a propeller generates thrust, one of the forces acting on it is called thrust bending. As the propeller pushes air backward, it pulls forward with an equal amount of force in accordance with Newton's third law. This force is applied to the blades, causing them to bend slightly forward. With ESR propellers, the blades are designed so that this bending changes its angle of attack. For example, during takeoff, when thrust is at its maximum, the blades bend forward, reducing the pitch angle. This lowers the propeller load and increases engine RPM. As the airplane accelerates toward cruise speed, the thrust generated by the blades decreases. With less thrust, the blades bend less, increasing the pitch angle. This coarser pitch raises the propeller load, reducing engine RPM. And just like that, we have an automatic constant speed propeller. However, this approach comes with some drawbacks. As the blade flexes forward, it lowers the pitch angle, but the blade tips tend to flex more than the blade root. This means the angle of attack at the blade tips decreases more than at the root, leading to uneven loading across the blade, something E-props have gone to great lengths to avoid. Because of this, E-props does not rely on blade bending to achieve the ESR effect. So then, how does E-props achieve ESR? As mentioned earlier, one major issue with increasing cruise speed thrust by making blade pitch coarser is that the blades can enter a stalled or partially stalled condition during takeoff. Making the pitch finer solves this problem, but comes at the cost of reduced thrust at high airspeed, which lowers cruise speed. So how can we increase cruise speed thrust without sacrificing takeoff thrust and vice versa? The answer lies in the E-props blade twist profiles. Blade twist refers to the variation in blade pitch from the root to the tip. This is necessary for all propellers because the tip of the blade spins much faster than the root. In flight, the faster spinning tip travels a greater distance along the propeller's plane of rotation than the distance it travels forward, compared to the blade root, which travels a comparatively greater distance forward than distance along the propeller's plane of rotation. This changes the angle at which certain blade sections cut through the air, with a higher angle of attack at the blade tip than the blade root. So, to maintain a consistent angle of attack across the entire blade, the blade must be twisted. Without this twist, the varying angle of attack along the blade span would lead to uneven loading. The amount of twist and its resultant load-changing properties also allows propeller manufacturers a way to optimize a propeller for certain applications. A typical propeller usually has blades twisted to achieve a higher angle of attack at the root, optimizing low-speed thrust, while the angle of attack at the tip is kept lower to minimize drag at high airspeeds. However, as the airplane accelerates and the effective angle of attack decreases, the load on the propeller also decreases, causing the propeller and engine RPM to increase. This is quite normal, but this contributes to a very narrow effective speed range. On a typical propeller, the change in pitch angle from root to tip can be quite dramatic. On the E-props, designers took a different approach, using a blade design with less twist from root to tip. The E-props blade root has a finer pitch angle compared to a typical propeller, while the tip has a coarser pitch angle. This design allows the propeller tips to maintain higher loading as the airplane accelerates, keeping RPM lower compared to a typical propeller, for which the lower angle of attack at the tips will result in less loading, substantially increasing engine RPM. With a typical propeller on a Rotax 9 series engine, RPM can easily vary by over 700 between takeoff and full power level flight. However, with an E-props propeller, RPM changes by only about 100 between takeoff to full power level flight. This means the engine retains more usable RPM in the cruise, reducing the need to throttle back to prevent engine overspeed. However, the lower blade twist on the E-props design introduced a few challenges. First, with a lower angle of attack at the blade root, takeoff thrust is compromised. Secondly, the higher angle of attack at the blade tips increases drag at high speeds. But the designers knew this and compensated for it by giving the blade a relatively wide root chord and very little taper towards the tip. Here's why this design decision makes a difference. A standard propeller blade typically has a narrow chord at the root, often to save weight and reduce drag. The chord then gradually widens toward the middle of the blade before tapering off again at the tip. In contrast, E-props blades are relatively thin corded, but the chord at the root is wider relative to the rest of the blade compared to a typical propeller. The chord then does not widen significantly toward the middle and only tapers slightly toward the tip. This gives the blade a different aerodynamic profile compared to a typical propeller. The relatively wide root chord of the E-prop solves the problem of the lower angle of attack at the root and helps achieve higher thrust at low airspeed. A wider root chord increases the weight and drag of a propeller. So, on typical propellers, it's an acceptable trade-off to keep the root chord narrower. However, because E-props are made from lightweight materials, they can afford a relatively wide root chord. The drag penalty is also minimal because while the root chord is wide in comparison to the median chord, it's still relatively thin when compared to other propellers. But what about high airspeeds? Remember, the E-props blades have a higher angle of attack at the tip compared to a typical propeller blade. The key here is the minimal taper from the blade's midsection towards the tip, which helps reduce vortex strength. A standard propeller blade with a wide chord in the midsection generates substantial thrust in those regions, but this typically occurs over a much narrower range of airspeeds. Less thrust is generated where the blade tapers toward the tip. Abrupt changes in thrust distribution along the blade result in strong tip vortices, which increases induced drag. By reducing the taper, the strength of the vortices is diminished, which improves the overall efficiency of the propeller. Blade tips are crucial for high-speed thrust as they are the fastest moving part of the blade. On the E-props, the higher angle of attack at the blade tips generates more load, helping to keep RPM lower while increasing thrust. And by reducing taper, tip vortices are minimized, improving high-speed efficiency by reducing drag. This contributes to the extended speed range by increasing thrust at higher airspeeds while keeping engine RPM lower. E-props further increase the speed range by shifting thrust from less usable speeds like 0 knots or static thrust to more usable airspeeds. Now, I understand that static thrust plays a role in short takeoff distances, especially in the super short takeoff airplane category, and static thrust is certainly not without value. This is an area where E-props often get criticized. Many pilots, especially on YouTube, have compared the static thrust of E-props to other popular propellers and found E-props lacking. However, this is also how one knows that someone didn't do their homework on the operation of E-props propellers. This isn't meant as judgment. I too initially thought the E-props were suboptimal for the short takeoff application. But this is a design feature, not a shortcoming. E-props have been designed to provide superior thrust in actual flying conditions as opposed to a boatload of thrust when the plane is, well, pulling against its brakes. After all, airplanes weren't made to plow farm fields at 5 miles per hour. E-props designed their propeller to operate in a partially stalled condition while static. This is why the propeller tends to show lower static thrust in tests. However, as soon as the airplane begins to move, the blades quickly get unstalled during the takeoff roll. Thrust increases to optimal and remains optimal as the aircraft accelerates up to its cruising speed. Static thrust test values on an E-props is essentially useless information and it's not an indication of its performance. My personal experience is that while the E-props doesn't lag far behind in the super stall application, it also doesn't beat the typical stall propeller options for short takeoffs specifically. For non-super stall applications, however, E-props considerably shortens takeoff distance as well as improves climb and cruise performance. I've left out some finer details about how E-props achieve ESR, like camber profiles, which I can't comment on without seeing actual camber cross-sections and airflow simulations. And then there's their ultra-lightweight design and efficiency through using thin cords, for which the benefits are obvious. However, the concepts covered should provide a solid understanding of the E-props propeller and how the ESR effect is primarily achieved. If you found this video informative, you'll also like these videos on propellers. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.